at this session. Just we'll do a couple more questions and then we'll get into this. We'll get all of it covered by the end of the day. We'll talk about this tonight, but I'm not a real schedule person. So the main thing is we'll have lunch and we'll be done at 2:30. Other than that, the day is going to flow a little better.
Which means he could be a nightmare for people who are planning. But I do want to say, speaking of schedules, I don't know if you made your way to the door up here, but this is an extremely creative way for the schedule to be posted. Did you know that that's what's written on that door? Yeah, you should go up and see it. Or not, because it apparently doesn't have that much to do with what we're going to do, but...
One of the questions I have, oh, go ahead.
Just quickly before you move on, can you explain your understanding of the verse, train up a child in the way they should go, and how to interpret that passage?
Okay. Question was, can we explain our view of the verse, train up a child the way it should go, and when he'll get old, he'll not depart from it. A lot of different views on this verse. I'll just start with that from well-meaning Christians. One in our family believes that that means if you do the right thing, your children are guaranteed that they will follow the Lord. I love my sister. I don't think that's what it is. Because again, we can't determine the decisions our children are going to make, as much as we would like to do that. I think it was Chuck Swindoll really was helpful, and he really developed this, but he said it really means train up a child according to their bent, according to how they are put together. And when they are old, they'll not depart from that. But there is a promise that they'll come back if they leave. But I think the first part of that is understand your child and know how different they are. Train them up in the way that works for them. And if you have more than one child, you've probably found out they're not the same, right? Like our daughter Carrie was born first, and that was a good thing. Because if Lisa had been born first, we would have thought we're the best parents on the face of the planet. Because Lisa came out and said, oh, thank you, Mom and Dad, for giving me life. You're so wonderful. Carrie came out, why'd you do this to me? So Carrie was our challenge at first, which was very helpful to us. And then Julie, very strong and vivacious, you know. So discipline with every one of them was very different. Lisa, if we looked at her, she'd say, I'm so sorry, I'll never do that again. Julie, we could spank her and she'll say, is that all you got? You know, so it just very, very different. So I think it takes knowing our child, knowing their temperament, knowing their personalities, knowing and saying, I want to help you grow into who God wants you to be. You know, the Proverbs are probabilities, but they're not absolutes. So there are two sides of parenting. One, some people will say it's all a crapshoot, it doesn't matter what you do. If your children's going to follow the Lord, they'll follow the Lord. If not, they won't. I think that's pretty discouraging. We think there are probabilities because we see parents who parent well tend to have children who make good decisions. Not always, but there's a probability. And so I think that's the goal. And I think the prayer is always, if your children have been raised in faith and they've departed from that, that they will come back. You just keep loving them, and that's important. One of the questions in the outside came that when you model, what if you model in such a way that sort of the standard is so high that your children give up and say, I'll never attain that? I think that's a great question. I think one of the questions we have to ask is what are we telling our children that they should be? Maybe we're successful in business and that's what we're implying to our children. Or maybe even in the area of faith, we do it this way. I was raised in a home that my parents believed that you model perfect living and that will inspire people. It discouraged many people. I'll never be like that. And sometimes we as parents, Virginia alluded to this, we are afraid to tell our children when we fail. because then mom and dad failed. So instead of, I think we do have to be transparent and say, well, I struggle with that. And here's what I did. Not just, everybody struggles, you're not gonna have any success, but I struggle with it and here's what I do. So I think we need to be transparent. But I think in the goals, we wanna make sure the goals that our kids hear us saying are goals that are faith goals, that are character goals, not vocational goals. I think we'll talk about this somewhere, that when our daughter Julie got involved with Derek, she wrote us once and said, when I'm with Derek, I grow closer to Christ. That's all a dad wants. That is my highest goal for our girls. Now, it didn't hurt that he was the executive director of this neurological pediatric hospital, but the main thing was that he helped her grow close to Christ. Okay? Another question? Then we'll go on to this next session. Okay. This next, third point is be there for them. Wow, it is tough, isn't it? Our lives are so busy. We've already alluded to that. There's so many demands for us to be everywhere, to be doing everything. And yet, there's something about the gospel you find that is very personable. In fact, in the verse in your outline, John 1:14, the Word, Jesus, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the only one who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. God sent Jesus, he didn't send a text, right? There's very personal involvement with Christ. And I'm always amazed when you read the Gospels and see the miracles, the healings, unless I'm mistaken, there is no mass healing in Scripture. Jesus is not efficient. He's personal. He could have just said, okay, you're all healed and go to the next thing. But he touched them one by one. He talked to them one by one. And I think our kids need us. They need time with us. It needs to be a huge priority for us.
But we're prone to imbalance. And so some of us will hear that, and we are in that group of people who make sure we're there for our children 24/7. And our worlds are child-centric, and if we're not there for them, they're probably not going to be able to be okay with that. That's imbalance on one end of the spectrum. The other is, kids can be so independent now. I've heard many, many parents who feel once their child gets to the middle school years, for instance, now they can be very independent. A lot of those kids come home to empty homes because they're legally allowed to be at home alone. There's an awful lot of abandonment, actually, I think it happens during the teen years, where parents either feel that their kids don't want them around, or they're so busy accumulating or working to make sure that they have all the things that they need that they end up not really having the time. I think it's challenging to get the right balance here, but there is no substitute for our personal involvement in the lives of our kids. Kind of no matter what they say. Because some of you have teenagers and you're like, well, I want to be with my kids. They just don't really want me to be there. If you're stepping into a situation where you have an instant family of teenagers, the challenges there will be greater because they haven't been used to that. If, however, you're on the end of the spectrum where you're raising young children, or you're like Reagan and Sydney about to welcome their first child into the world, maybe on Easter Sunday, they get to start knowing that investing in their children, they'll establish a pattern. So that by the time they're in their teen years, it won't be foreign or strange or something that they don't expect, because that's what our family system does. That's how we do it. The family night deal that we have, we launched when our kids were like 3, 5, and 7. And by the time they were teenagers, we didn't have to have any discussions. We didn't have to have any threats. We didn't have to coerce our girls into family night. That's just what we did in our family. And interestingly to us, when our oldest daughter went out to college, when she was home on break, she would say, okay, it's Tuesday night, who has family night tonight? It had been so ingrained in her that that's kind of what we do. Hopefully that's what our commitment to being in church with God's people is, the patterning that we do the priority we place on that.
Yeah,
interestingly, I was going to use that, Pat, as an example of how... Yeah, thanks, Pat. You came in at just the right time, just like I had asked you to. Actually, I wanted to use it as an example earlier because our oldest daughter and her husband, Gabe, their kids are 3, 6, and 8 months. And they instituted family night a year ago. Only they've taken it up a notch. They have a family night journal, which is just a 3-ring binder. And whatever family night was, they take a picture of it. And sometime in that week before the next family night comes around, their 6-year-old Brandon, who really likes to draw, draws a picture of the night and puts down a couple words of what they did, and then they put a picture in it. And I was looking at this when I was at their house a couple weeks ago. It's not gonna win any art award, it's not gonna be submitted for publication. I mean, it's just a very earthy, organic record of their family nights. But it touched me so deeply to see them doing it, not just that they're having family nights, but they're establishing a record of their life. This is part of their fabric of their family life. And I just want to tell you, at some point in time, that's going to speak volumes into those kids when they're teenagers or when they're starting their families. There's no substitution for investing personally with our kids. And I want to tell you why that's so much harder today than it's ever been. Because everybody has something in their hand. We're going to get to that more. I realize that. But can I just tell you that when you're sitting around a table and everybody is texting, you're not spending quality time together. So, put them away. We're going to have a whole section a little bit later on media, so we'll make everybody feel terrible. But we need to, because if we don't feel terrible about this, we are not going to take any corrective measures. And I just want to tell you, we're all worried. Start reading the articles of what is happening to the minds of our children who are glued to screens constantly. Just take a snapshot of the average teenage gathering and notice that they don't talk to each other. They don't make eye contact. They text one another. So I'll get off my soapbox for a moment to return to the point of this, which is don't miss what you have. It's so easy, and it's been, you know, asked how you juggle everything. There are tremendous pressures on us, tremendous opportunities, tremendous good opportunities. How do we sort it all out? How do we make decisions that are going to best serve the ultimate purposes that God has given us for our families? And so I'm just going to give you a little formula that worked for us. Because at every age and stage, you're going to have possibilities and opportunities that are good, but that are not the best. How do you sort out what is the best? When Paul and I moved back to New England in 1991, for Paul to pursue his master's degree in family ministries at Gordon-Conwell, I had read that wives could go for free. Their husband was a full-time paying student, the wife could go for free. Our children at the time were 6, 8, and 11. We had lived a little idyllic life in a very sheltered cove on Catalina Island. We were going back to New England for just 1 year. But I found out that I could take some courses for free, so I went up to register thinking, though I'm going to be homeschooling the girls for this 1 year, I can take a few classes that will begin working towards my master's in counseling. How great. I can do that for free. Went up to the registrar to register for one class. She said, oh, I'm so sorry, but you have to be a full-time student also to take advantage of this grant. And I said, oh, well, I can't. I mean, you have 3 kids, and we're homeschooling them. My husband's a full-time student. We've been in ministry for our whole marriage. I can only take one class. And she said, well, that would be fine, but you'd have to pay for that one class. You only can take advantage of the grant if you're full-time. Well, I left the registration without registering for anything because I knew that I couldn't be a full-time student. Well, Paul was a full-time student. Well, we had 3 full-time students in our home that we were schooling. And as I trudged down the hill from the registration office back to our on-campus apartment, I thought, it was hard to pass up a free master's degree, but I'm pretty sure this is really the right decision. Now, I'm a girl who still gets excited about free samples at Costco. So imagine you're walking away from a free master's degree. But honestly, I just didn't look back. I just knew that was the right decision. I knew those degrees were always going to be there. Somehow God really pressed on me, your kids really aren't always going to be there. And that spawned some thinking within me, which was, in any given moment, one of the questions that will help me to figure out how to do life is, if I add 10 years to where I am now and look back, what will I most regret having missed? Or another way of looking at it is, 10 years from now, when I look back, what will I recognize was available 10 years ago that is no longer available to me? And that was very, very clarifying to me, because I realized the degrees were always going to be there, but time was marching on, and in 10 years, our girls would be 16, 18, and 21. Two of them would most likely be out of the house in college, and there were a whole lot of things that would no longer be available to me that were available to me at this juncture of them being 6, 8, and 11. Fast forward to the year 2003, so 12 years passed by. Our youngest daughter is positioned to be launched to college, and we've made the decision, we feel led by God, to resign from our position at our church and develop this ministry that we're currently involved in, Home Improvement Ministries. We met with our mentoring professor, the same one whose father told him at 12, well, if you don't go to church, where are you going to live? And Dr. Pendleton said to us, for this next season of your life, as you go developing this family ministry, you both need to have your doctorates. Now, you both have your master's degrees, right? And Paul was very happy to quickly volunteer that he did. And I explained to Ray the same story that I just told you, which was I had had that opportunity, but I passed it by to raise our kids. And in a moment that could only have come from heaven, Dr. Pendleton said to me, I don't know if you know this, but we can invite one person into our Doctor of Ministry cohort that doesn't have the prerequisite master's degree, but whose life experience we feel has prepared them to directly enter into the program. And we're going to invite you to be that student.
Really tipped me off. I mean, I haven't.
As you can see, it's as meaningful to me today as it was in 2003. Because I honestly felt like God just pulled back the curtains of heaven and said, you made the right decision in 1991, and I'm now making a way for you to be prepared to do what you have been preparing to do all of your life, which is to develop this ministry to families. And I don't tell you that story because I believe that everybody should make the same decisions that we make. I feel God leads our families differently. And if you happen to be a dual income, both of you working full time and managing your household, and you feel that's exactly what God has asked you to do, I would die if you left thinking that we've now stood in judgment of you or said what you're doing is not right. Please don't hear that. That's not what we're saying at all. What I am saying is every one of us needs to regularly check in to make sure that the decisions we're making today, we won't regret 10 years from now. Because I don't know how you're experiencing life, but for us, it is flying by. And when I think, oh, 10 years from now, that just seems like eternity. When I look back and think, oh my goodness, no, it was like that. So be there for your children. Seek God, let Him direct your steps. Check in with your kids, find out what they're saying. Do they feel like you're really there for them in the ways that they need you to be there for them? Regularly checking in on that is just gonna help you fulfill this desire of your heart and God's call to you.
As Virginia said it earlier, you know, sometimes we'll say, well, I'll be home with my 4-year-old, but my 14 can be home alone. I think it's much more dangerous leaving a 14-year-old home alone than a 4-year-old.
And it's not so recommending that you leave
not
your
that
four-year-old.
I believe you should leave a 4-year-old. We need to be there for them. But it is tough. And this comes again from our highest priority. We hear people all the time say, well, I wish we both didn't have to work full-time outside the home, but in order to live in, we have to. Or in order to make our mortgage payment, we have to. Whatever you have, the second part, that's your highest priority, or the first part, that's your highest priority. in order to live in Auburn, we both have to work. In order to have our house, we both have to work. The highest value is in order to live in Auburn, to live in this house. If you say, in order for us both not to have to work full time, that's your highest value, then you make decisions. We move to Kansas or something. You see that? It's again saying, what is the highest priority? Again, God's going to lead all of us differently, but keep saying, what is the highest value that we have? And arrange your lives in ways that you can be at things, of your kids. One of the memories I have still to this day is my dad traveling to an away game where I was on the C reserve football team and sat on the bench. But my dad was in the stands because he came to what I was at. Our daughter Julie and Lisa both played sports. And I remember Julie came home when one of her teammates had a 16th birthday, and she said, for this girl's 16th birthday, her parents got her a brand new BMW. And we said, well, that's interesting, which means dream on, sweetheart. And then 2 weeks later, Julie came home, and this same girl, Miss BMW, looked to the stands, and she pointed to Virginia and me, where virtually both of us, or at least one of us, was always in a game. And Miss Beamer pointed and said, I'd give it all back. She said, I've played 3-season sports for 4 years. My parents have never been to a game. She came home, told us that, and we said, well, it was either give you a Beamer or go to your games. We went to your games. But you know, be intentional. Most of us will say, oh, I'd love to be at this, but I can't. It means, did we try? Did we ask our boss, can I take 3 hours off and work later? Or can I work from home today and do this? Just be there, our kids. And they won't usually say, oh, it means the world to me that you sacrificed and came. But be there, because it does mean a lot to them.
But we're also going to say, be willing to miss something your kids are in to build into your marriage. We have a marriage conference next weekend. We're doing a Newport, Rhode Island. Several of our clients over the last month, we've suggested strongly that they come to the marriage conference. We said, you're in a tough place. You need to be in a place where you're going to be really built into, where you can get away from everything, where you can keep working on your marriage. Oh, no, no, I can't. You know, my kid has a soccer game. My kid has whatever. If your normal pattern is being there for your kids, they're not going to come undone when you miss one strategically, or you miss some, and you let them know how much committed we are to your games, but Daddy and I are going to be gone to this marriage conference this weekend. Hate to miss it, but we'll look forward to the text for you letting us know how things go. An action our kids can handle. It's just if the rule is that we never have time for them, we're throwing a lot of stuff at them, we're providing a lot for them, but we're not actually there for them. That just never goes down well.
A practical thing we did in our home, I had daddy-daughter dinners. And so when the girls were young, we went out to, it was like a Denny's, it was a Friendly's back our way. And we go out, and once a month, we go out together. And when they were very young, and sometimes the most important thing that was shared was how good the French fries were. And you could think, what a waste. I just spent this time, and there was no significant conversation. But you know, as we did that, sometimes they said, I had somebody said something really mean to me today. And then we start having conversation. As our girls got older, I took them out one at a time. So once a month, each of us would have a meal together, breakfast before we took them to school or whatever it was. Just time with them, that's absolutely critical. Because what you want your children to know is that you love them, you want to be there for them, you're interested in them. Not just that they perform correctly. I remember when Julie came home one day from school, and this is years ago now, remember, she's now 31, she was 16, and in our home, there are some words we didn't use, and she came home from school, she was so aggravated, and she said, this whole thing is a bunch of crap. And we didn't say crap, that was a word we didn't use. And then, for some reason, I didn't stop her. I let her keep going, and she said, and the whole thing sucks. Well, if crap is bad, sucks definitely was not allowed. And let her go, and at the end I said, I'm so sorry you've had such a tough day. And I realized that earlier in parenting, I would have stopped her at crap. And I was like, we don't say that. And I would have lectured her about saying crap. And all Julie would have heard me say is, you really don't care about me. You don't care about my day. You don't care about how upset I am. All of you have your little rules that we don't say crap in the family. And we want to make sure that our children know we're there for them, our heart is for them. We're more interested in connecting with them than just that they hop through all the hoops. Now, later in the day, we went back and we talked about crap and sucks. So it doesn't mean you never address these things, but I think sometimes we just come unglued and all our children, the mom and dad, they're going to be at me all the time telling me everything I've done wrong. Be there for them. Rules without relationship produce rebellion. Rules without relationship produce rebellion. We need to have rules. There are definitely rules, because relationship without rules produce chaos. So both are necessary, but we need to make sure. Sometimes in the Christian community, we're concerned about it, but our kids follow all the rules, and we're on them all the time, and we discourage them instead of encourage them. Okay? Fourthly, help them develop personal convictions. And we'll get through part of this, I think. I don't think we'll finish this one. This is from Joseph's life. Joseph and Potiphar, when he's tempted, he says, no one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? We need to help our children have personal convictions. I don't mean this to be discouraging, but the day of parental control is over. When we raised our children, there was one TV. We had control of it. There was a phone, and it had a cord attached to the wall, and we were in charge of it. Television, computer, there was one computer, it was a big one, and it was in one room. We took turns using it. And we could control it. We could control it all. Now, it's a little handheld device, and it's a cell phone. We're not against having guidelines and controls on our children, especially as they're young. But the reality is, if they don't have personal convictions, somebody else has a phone they can look at. That's what's going to make the difference in their life, is their personal conviction. So that's really where we want to focus on here. And we want to divide it in two areas. One is young children. Because when we have young children, we do discipline them. That's part of our training of them. The word discipline is very different than punishment. Discipline is training them in the things they should do, and training them to not do the things that will be harmful to them.
And so the main focuses of discipline are to train godly character and values in our kids. I think sometimes when we hear the word discipline, we immediately go to punishment, and we think, okay, what kind of response do we need to have to their behavior to make sure that it curbs the bad behavior? And we spend a lot of our time thinking of how to leverage our power or authority in our lives to get our children to conform to a behavioral standard that we've decided is important. And I'm not suggesting that there's something wrong inherently in that, but if that's the extent of our discipline, it will produce legalism in our kids, where they will learn how to conform externally, but all manner of craziness is going on inside of them, and it will come out eventually. Talk to any person in administration at a Christian college about the freshman class of students, and they will tell you that they can tell immediately the kids who have been raised in homes where legalism or behavioral conformity was the highest goal. Because the minute those kids get out from underneath the reaches of their parents, a lot of them just go crazy. They all of a sudden are looking at the smorgasbord of activities that have been off limits to them, and because they haven't developed godly character, personal convictions, and self-discipline, they don't know what to do with that freedom. So for those of you who are raising children that are still in your home, this is a very, very, very important principle, is that the object of our discipline needs to be training godly character and inculcating biblical values in our kids from the inside out. I mean, none of us would say, oh yeah, all we want is for them to look like they're doing the right thing, but we don't really care what's really going on. But see, we all want there to be a congruency between external and internal posturing. But it's actually true for many of us. We learned to play the game a long time ago, and we know where we have to behave right. And many of us, to be very honest, as adults, settle for appearance management rather than for genuine transformation. Appearance management says, as long as it looks like I'm doing the right thing, that's going to be good enough. Nobody's going to know differently. And this huge gap exists in our life between who people think we are and who we really are. And to be honest, that just does a number on us. It's actually a fairly big contributor to, sometimes to mental illness even, when there is this huge gap between who people think we are and who we really are. God is never going to be satisfied with appearance management. That's not what he wants. That's what the Pharisees were so good at. Well, as long as I whitewash the outside of the cup, who cares what's on the inside of it? God cares. God cares very, very much. And so as we approach this area of helping your children develop personal conviction, self-discipline, inside-out approach to the gospel, I think that's really where we want to set our sights. That's what we want to be focusing on.
And again, as you're raising them, you need to be the parent. It sounds so elementary, but be the parent. We were just with a couple last night in Reno, and they're telling us about their 13-year-old son who has a girl who's texting him all the time and saying, let's go out, let's be boyfriend, girlfriend, and the mom is trying to, let's go to the movies, and the mom is trying to do everything she can just to put this off, just to put this off. And finally, she just said to her son, she said, son, why am I going to take you to the movies so you can make out with this girl? And you're not doing that. So let's stop having this discussion. You're 13. And he said, okay, mom, I got it. What he was saying is, okay, you're the parent. You ultimately are the one who is going to, and as long as our children are home, we are the parent. And I think too often we have given up on that. When our children are very young, we can establish some things that are going to be patterns that hopefully will lead them to convictions they'll have when they're older. So just a few very practical things on this. We had in our home the phrase that the displeasure of the discipline must exceed the pleasure of the disobedience. Just a simple sort of formula for discipline. The displeasure of the discipline must exceed the pleasure of the disobedience. When I was a young boy, I was acting up at home, at the table. My dad said, if you're not going to behave, you have to go to your room. I said, okay, so I went to my room. He came in about 10 minutes later and said, are you ready to come back to the table? I said, no, Dad, I'm fine, thanks. Well, I didn't want to be at the table anyway. So that discipline was not effective. Do you follow that? You know your children. For some of our children to say they can't play with their friends, that's it. Or they can't watch television. Or they can't use their phone. Or pick it in. Pick whatever it is that has the most leverage. Because if you don't, they'll say, yeah, I'll pay the fine and continue to do the disobedience. Because there's more pleasure in that.
So the real question you have to ask is the discipline is what you're leveraging, accomplishing the goal of incentivizing behavior that's consistent with what you want. I was with a young mom who said, I realize that there's a huge spectrum of people's position on spanking, for instance, and we're not going to get into spanking except to say that in this situation, it was the mom who believed that any kind of spanking was off limits. And understandably for her, she had been raised in a very abusive home and had been beaten by her parents. And I, I could totally understand where she was coming from. But as we sat at her kitchen table, I watched her two-year-old climb up on the counter, and he was standing right in front of the magnetic strip that had a series of very sharp knives. And I had watched her three different times say to him, no, don't go up on the counter. You can't get up on the counter. You can't. Don't get up on that counter. And she's watching him get up on the counter. She only got out of her seat to grab him when he reached for one of the knives. And I said to her, I completely respect that you are spanking averse. I said, my challenge to you, however, is that you're going to need to develop a form of discipline that actually does work for him, because your voice is meaningless. I just watched. She'd asked me to mentor her, so this was invited advice. She had watched him completely blow her off. He was only two, and he exhibited that strength of will against her authority as his mom. The question is, are you getting what you hope to see develop in your child, looking at them from the inside out? So the displeasure, and we're not in any way ever advocating anything that would be harmful to a child, obviously. What is it that works? My daughter Carrie was a figure skater. It worked to leverage her practice time, for instance. I'm watching young parents now take away, as Paul said, iPads or other electronic devices or television, maybe food, maybe something, maybe an activity, maybe playing with a friend. There are many, many things that, in knowing your child, you will come to something that is going to actually work for them.
In having this sort of discipline, we're going to say, have fewer rules, but enforce them. Consistency is really hard, isn't it? To be consistent, we say this is what it is, but then we don't follow through. The story is told when I was 3 years old that my mom was 9 months pregnant with my sister, and I had toys spread out over the living room, and she said, Paul, you need to pick up your toys because we're going to leave. And I said, no, I'm not going to do it. And she said, no, you have to pick up your toys. We're going to leave. And I said, no. And she said, if you don't pick up your toys, I'm going to come pick you up, I'm going to put you on the stairs, and you're going to sit there until you pick up your toys. I said, you're too fat, you can't catch me. Well, Mama caught me. And the story told was I sat on the stairs for 8 hours. Now, I'm telling you that story because back then I had a strong will, not at all now, but back then I did. The other thing is, I don't know what my mom had planned. We were on our way somewhere. She did nothing for 8 hours. Because she told me, you're going to sit there until you pick up your toys. Most of us, after 20 minutes, say, okay, we've got to go. And the child goes, I'm still in charge. I'm still in charge. See, what I found out that day was no matter how fat Mama was, she's in charge. That when she says, you do this, she means it. She didn't throw a tantrum, didn't scream at me. She just said, that's your choice. You've got to sit there. I didn't get fed. We have parents who feed their children in a situation like that. You don't need to feed your children. Children go days without eating. You said, you're not going to eat until you eat this. Follow through with it. Give them some water so they don't get dehydrated, but that's all they need. Follow through. And I can't tell you, a woman just told us last night, this meeting we were at, that when they followed through with discipline, their child said, I can't believe you followed through. You usually don't. Our children actually find security when our discipline is consistent. So fewer rules, but follow through with them.
But really do think about it before you say it, because effective discipline does require follow through. You don't want your kid to get to the comatose state where, I don't know if you remember that Far Side cartoon where Fido was sitting next to his master and they had the bubble above Fido's head. All Fido heard was blah, 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 Fido, blah, 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 Fido, blah, 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 Fido. Some of our kids have become that way with us because they realize that we don't really mean what we say. I remember we lived on Catalina and our kids were like 1, 3, and 5. We were going to do a very, very unusual thing and go out to dinner at this little Mexican restaurant that was right downtown because we had friends in town. And the girls, one of our children was not being very obedient as the afternoon wore on, I said, honey, you need to choose to be obedient. Remember, we're going to get to go out to dinner tonight. We're going to have this really fun celebration. I was finally so exasperated with her that I said, okay, if you do that again, you're not going out to dinner with us. And she was 3, and I guarantee you she thought, what is she going to do, leave me home alone? So she did it again. And she was as surprised as I was that one of us stayed home that evening with her. We realized we kind of boxed ourselves in a corner. We'd said she wasn't going to go out to dinner if she did that again, and she disobeyed us, so we really had to follow through. So my advice to you is think through what you threatened to do before you say it, because if it's going to be at all effective, you're going to have to follow through. Now, you could say something ridiculous, like if you do that again, you're going to get restricted for a year. And then you can't enforce that, right? So then you go back and you say, I'm so sorry, I was really just foolish when I said that. This is what the, you know, punishment is going to be.
I think the last thing I want to say in this discipline is be united on your discipline with each other. One of the things is parents sometimes correcting each other in front of their children. A child says, you know, you say to your child, you're grounded for a week. And the other parent says, I think that's a little strong. And then the parents start arguing. Whatever the discipline is, unless it's going to harm the child, you follow through with it. You support each other. Then you go in the bedroom and say, are you crazy? Why'd you say that? And you have this discussion. And then you may come back and say, you know, Mom and I have talked, or Dad and I have talked, and we're changing what we said. But don't pit yourself against each other. Don't be the good parent, bad parent, easy parent, strong parent. You want to parent together.
Because that not only is far more effective in discipline, but it also creates far more stability and security for our children. You know, children just naturally know where to infiltrate the borders that are weak, right? They figure it out pretty early, and it's often that one parent is more strict and more prone to follow through than the other. Kids, it takes them about 9 seconds to figure that out, and they're gonna go to the easier parent time and again. No matter what the stronger parent is gonna say, they know how to divide us. So be smart, watch for that dynamic, and don't play into it. It doesn't do anybody any good.
Okay, we're gonna take just a couple.
Can I say about the marble jar?
Yeah, sure.
There's one last thing I want to say here, and that is that we've talked a little bit about, you know, leveraging or penalties or punishment and that to kind of reinforce, but positive reinforcement has been proven to be far more effective, quite honestly, than negative consequences. Now, sometimes negative consequences are the best teachers for our kids, right? You let them live with the decision they make or the result of it, and that can be extremely formative for them. But I'm just going to encourage you to look for ways to positively reinforce your children's good behavior. Again, going back to when our kids were quite young, they 3 girls, each 2 years apart, sibling rivalry was always barking at the door. And we really did want to have a home that we honored each other. We were far more concerned about how we treated each other within the home than we were about outside of the home, because we figured that naturally there are all sorts of societal mores that draw out better behavior. We just seen so many Christian homes go up in flames, and we felt part of it was so much disrespect within the home. So we wanted our place to be safe for our kids. We didn't want them to be bullies to each other. Legislated at school they couldn't be, but let them be bullying, tearing each other at home, we didn't want that. So it was actually Paul's sister who told us about their system, which was called the marble jar. And let me tell you very quickly that our kids are using this right now, and each of them have physicians in their lives who have come over for dinner and said, don't ever have marbles around young children. So can I just say, keep the jar up really, really high. But this is how it works. We just got a little basket of marbles, and I started with a half pint canning jar. Like, it's on the table, not the giant ones, that one right there being held up here with hearts in it. And we explained to the girls that every time either Daddy or I caught them doing the right thing, we would put a marble in the jar. So if it was first time obedience, if they picked up after themselves, we asked them to do something, they were helpful to a sister, they shared a toy, we saw kindness, we saw Christ-likeness. We were going to celebrate that by putting a marble in the jar, one jar for all 3 girls. Never pit your children against each other in a competitive setting to prove their goodness. It will have the reverse effect. So we had this one jar, and we said, every time we will put a marble in the jar, when we see your good behavior, your kindness, your Christ-likeness, and when the jar is full, we're going to celebrate it. And then we asked them, what would celebrations look like for it? And it was things, it, you know, 3 and 5 and 7, it's things like going out to get ice cream or going to the zoo or doable, inexpensive things. That's what they could come up with. We made that list, put it on the refrigerator. And I just want to tell you, I don't really believe in magic, but it kind of worked like magic for our kids. Maybe they're just so deprived for rewards, I'm not sure, but whatever. The rules were that they couldn't tell us when to put a marble in the jar, and we would never take marbles out of the jar. So if they did something really kind and the next month they walloped their sister, we didn't go in and cancel the good behavior. We let that marble stay, but we might not just kind of just have an opportunity to get a marble by being kind. And I just want to tell you, for all of us, and maybe the biggest change was for me, because I really feel as a well-meaning parent, I wanted to catch anything that could grow into rebellion or bad behavior or disobedience. So I feel like I was on the girls like a hawk watching. Once we started the marble jar, I was still watching, but I was watching for good behavior. And I just want to tell you, it changed the glasses through which I saw the girls. It was amazing. But it also changed them. They saw what fun it was to actually be cooperative, to obey, to be kind to their sister, to be sharing. And I'll tell you, we used that successfully for quite a few years with our girls. We graduated to a larger jar, so we didn't have to be going out constantly for reward, but it really worked. So that may be an idea that will spawn another idea that works for you. Look for ways to reinforce positive behavior.
Okay, we're going to take just one or two questions, if you have it, on being there for your children or just as part of discipline we've covered thus far. Any questions or a neighbor that you have? Yes.
This sort of happened in my childhood, but now we have kids who have enough allowance to either go buy their own iPad, iPhone, iPod, or grandparents give them to them. And then, if you want to try and take that away, they say that's not yours, that's not
okay, if I heard correctly, our kids have allowance, have money, they're buying their own things, and who are you to take that away? That's mine. Take it away. Very simply, you're still the parent. Because that sort of thing, they say, well, I buy these clothes, you can't tell me what I can wear or what I can't wear, because I bought the clothes, and your daughter's wearing something that makes her look like a hooker. And you just, she said, well, that's what I want to wear. Now, you're still the parent. Or I bought my own car, so you can't tell me where I can go. Did you want to live here, son? I mean, you can live on your own. That's your choice. But as long as you're under this roof, we're sort of providing a number of things for you. And we actually are still the parent. That's the role that God has given us. And so as long as you're growing towards the right direction, that's fine, but we will take your iPad away, even if you bought it, because of what it's doing. So I think we still have to, again, hear that with a relationship. They need to know we're there for them, but ultimately, because what that's saying is the child is saying, I don't live under authority, which is a huge issue. And we'll talk a little more about that later, but saying, nobody tells me what to do. And you say, no, actually God has told me that I am the one who is responsible for raising you. And scripture doesn't say a lot, but it says, children, obey your parents. And it says, parents, don't discourage your children. Don't exasperate them. And my role is to try to raise you in a way that's not discouraging, but you need to know your role is to obey what I do.
But have those conversations before they get any of those devices. Can I say that? I think that retroactively, we often think, oh, never thought that was going to be an issue. Never even thought to talk about that. Or, and I just wanted to avoid the conflict, so I didn't. Or, I just assumed that he would know that he's a child and I'm still the authority in his life. So whatever the explanation is, try to have those conversations before any of those devices come into your home. I'll be very honest with you, we don't believe in privacy in terms of your children's device, that they can have you locked out of it with their password, that you don't have any business to know what's going on in their text messaging or what apps they have. You know, I can have Snapchat if I want, I can have whatever. No, they need to know that everything that comes underneath your roof in your home while you have jurisdiction over your kids is their parents. This is God's design, because they are never designed to be the ultimate authority in their lives, which is what all of this leads to. So have a conversation and say, listen, these are my, we have a very dear friend who works for Apple Computer, and when we were sitting at their dinner table 2 years ago, when their 12-year-old son said, but Dad, why can't I have an iPhone? You know, his father is responsible for the design work of everything that starts with an I that Apple produces. So we're not just talking about a lackey at Apple. This is one of the highest ranking level people in Apple Computer. He said, Dad, why can't I have a computer? I don't understand why I can't have an iPhone. Everybody in my class has an iPhone. Of course, I live in Los Gatos. Everybody has everything. And his dad said, I know, son. I said, Dad, everybody in my Christian school, everybody has an iPhone. I don't understand why I can't have one. And his dad said, well, one day you'll have one, but there are just certain things that we want to see maturationally and just from a milestone standpoint before we feel you're really ready to handle it. His dad said, because I know the potency of an iPhone. I happen to have helped design it. And I thought to myself, what a brilliant dad. To be honest, I would imagine that there are many Apple employees whose six-year-olds have every device that comes off the line. But he said, this isn't really going to be good for you. I am the parent. Part of my job is to protect you from the potential things that would be really harmful to you. The family we sat with last night, she said, my son knows I read every one of his text messages. There's plans that you set up where everything that your child has go through their devices also comes through yours. Do not have your head in the sand on this. The world is crushing our kids with these things. And if we're not on top of it, and if we don't believe that we have authority over it, I feel we kind of are feeding them to the wolves.
Okay, one more? Yes.
Dr. Paul, when your kid's little, I don't know
what the game was. I think it was going to ring on my ears just one.
What would you say?
Oh, sure. If you don't talk to them.
Well, when my kids were young, I came up with something I believe was inspired by God, but I brought home my paycheck and $5 bills. And some eyes really opened up. And I said, you like me to walk down the street safely? Okay, this goes for police protection. Do you like the fact that evil countries aren't attacking us? This goes for the military. Do you like living in this house? We need a little bit from each of you for that. It's kind of like a Monopoly game in reverse. And boy, it became, their whole attitudes changed like overnight. That was a really cool experience.
Great. Okay, David, get back to you. And then we'll pick this up after lunch.
Who, when their children turned 16, the parents turned the family finances over to them for 1 year. Not without guidance. Obviously, they gave them guidance, but they wanted them to know that electricity just didn't come for free, and water didn't come for free, and that rent for a house was really expensive, and the groceries. And they said that year experiment in each of their lives when they were 16 prepared them more for adulthood than anything else they had done. And none of them ended up bankrupting the family. It was great.
That's not going to happen in your house. just telling you. I mean, you're not my child, but I'm just telling you that's not going to happen.